Good morning, beloved, and welcome to worship today. We want to extend a special hello to our online viewers and invite you to make your presence known. If you're joining us in the sanctuary, please fill out your connection card and place it in the offering plates. If this is your first time joining us, we are especially happy you're here. Please be sure to pick up a welcome bag from the table in the entryway. It has lots of information about the church, and it will help you get acquainted with us. August newsletters are on the entryway welcome table. And if you would like to be a part of our newsletter email list, please make a note on your connection card along with your email address. Beginning in September, Pastor Ann will be holding a membership class after worship. If you're interested in joining the church, please let the office know so we can have the appropriate amount of class materials. For you who will be attending the Central District meeting at Christ UMC this coming Saturday, please check with the office about carpooling information. Please check your bulletin for more announcements, and please stand and join me for our morning prayer. After prayer, would you please stand as you are able to sing? Holy Father, Almighty God, we boldly claim to be your forgiven, redeemed, and beloved children by the blood of the Lamb and the words of our testimonies. Help us to eagerly share our testimony in the hope that no one will be lost. Thank you for guiding us through another week. Thank you for protecting those who protect us and for hearing our prayers. We pray for healing of our nations, our bodies, and our souls. We ask that you warm our hearts and focus our thoughts only on you, our Lord and Holy Spirit, so that our worship will be worthy and joyful to your ears. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
At your name, the mountains shake and crumble. At your name, the oceans roar and tumble. At your name, angels will bow, the earth will rejoice, your people cry. Your name, O Lord. find in me thine all in all. Jesus, pay it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Before you turn and greet everybody, I want to give a public service announcement. I brought in 1 million cantaloupe and 1 million tomatoes today from Phil's garden by his orders. He's out of town, so he said, you have to go pick those. Can you imagine asking me to do that? Go pick those and take them in. Those cantaloupes weigh 100 pounds, so you better take them home because I'm not taking them home. So, turn and greet each other. Boys and girls, if you want to come on up. Hi, Mackenzie.
Hi,
Hey, beautiful people. Oh, all these sunshiny, hey, come have a seat. I'm so glad you're here. Oh, and Miss Zion. How are y'all? Good? I've got a little picture here. Can you tell me what that picture is of? What's that look like? Sand? Yeah, there is some sand down there at the bottom. What do you see up here? God? Wow. How about right up here? What do you call those things? Clouds? Okay. Are these what we call mountains? Mountains, yes. And are mountains high or low? High. Okay, so what is the, do you know what the area is called? If you have two mountains here, what's that called in the middle? Do you know? You had that yet in school? Starts with the letter V. Mountains and valleys, aha, good. So sometimes we talk about our life as mountains and valleys. Sometimes when we're feeling really good, you get up and you say, I feel good, na 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 na. You're on a mountain. But when you get up and you don't feel so good, you're in a valley. And I want to tell you today about a man named Job. Isn't that an interesting name? Nobody ever names their children that, ever. Job. And I'll tell you why. Job was a man who had a lot of good things going for him. He was having a mountaintop experience because he was rich. He had lots of possessions. He had a big family. But the main thing about Job was that he was a good man. And he praised God and he worshiped God. But you know what happened? Everything Job had was wiped out. All his family was taken away. All of his possessions were taken away. And he, in fact, he even was, he had sores all over him. Like not just one boo-boo, but boo-boos everywhere. From the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. Now, if you were Job, you would say that you were in the valley then, but how do you think Job felt? Hurt. He did. Now, let me tell you about Job. This is what makes him so interesting. When he was up at the top of the mountain, he praised God for all the good things. But do you know what he did when he was in the valley with all the bad things happening to him? No, he still praised God. He praised God in the good days and on the bad days. And so that's what I want to remind you. When you wake up and it's a good day and you feel good, na 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 na, praise God. But when you wake up and you're like, ugh, today is not going to be a good day. Have you ever had a day like that? You've never had that so good. I'm so glad. But there have been times when I've woken up. Not very often, because I'm a pretty positive person. But if you do have a bad day, you still need to praise God. Because God never changes. God is still good. So we praise God in the good days, on the mountaintops, and we praise God on the bad days in the valley. Can you remember that? When do we praise God? On the mountaintop, and where else do we praise God? In the valley. Good job. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for these children. I thank you for that you are who you are, Lord, that you love us when we're good. You love us when we're bad. You love us when we're quiet. You love us when we're noisy. Lord, you just love us, and you never change, and we thank you for that, Jesus. Help us to praise you on our good days and our bad days. We love you, Jesus, and it's in your name we pray these things. Amen. Good job, guys. You may go back to your seats. Yeah, woo! Oh, yeah. Look at you, big girl. I'm so glad you guys are here today. It is a good day to be in the house of the Lord. I did want to let you know my mom had back surgery last Monday, and she's doing really well. The surgery went great. I think it's hard for her to not be well right away. You know how that is? Like, we think we're going to have the surgery and then we're going to be doing jumping jacks. So, it's going to take her a little bit of time, but she's making good progress. And if she could just learn how to run her dishwasher, that would be a good thing. She got, She got a brand new dishwasher right before she had surgery, and obviously I'm the only one that knows how to work it. So that's okay. So anyway, I know you come today with things on your heart, things on your mind. I want to give you some time to talk to Jesus. So Sharon's going to call us to prayer, and then we're going to pray. Oh, Father God, how we love you and how we praise your name. Lord, you are worthy of all our praise. You are so beautiful. You're so magnificent, righteous, holy, patient, loving. We just praise you for who you are. And Father, we thank you for who we are in you, that we are made in your image. That's amazing, Lord. Thank you for that. Father, I just pray, send your Holy Spirit now in this place. Holy Spirit, come, fall on this place. Fill us up with your love. Give us ears to hear and eyes to see and a will to be in line with your will, Lord. Father, life is not always easy. We acknowledge that, but Lord, we are so grateful that you walk along beside us every step of the way. And Father, for those who could not be here today, we ask mercy upon them, whether it's traveling mercies or healing mercies, Lord, we ask that you are sufficient to their every need. And this day, Lord, let us be a light to the world to tell others who you are and how you love. And as we remember the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, we lift our voices as one saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to continue now in our time of worship as we offer back to God his tithes and our offerings.
And he will.
singing of the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
Church. Father, we are so blessed to be able to lay these, your tithes and our offering, on the altar, Lord. You have blessed us so we can bless others. And so, Lord, we say to you, glorify yourself, Lord, and advance your kingdom through these tithes and offerings. We love you, Jesus. And it's in your precious name we pray these things. Amen. You may be seated. I'm sorry. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. I'm so sorry you feel that way. No, I did Mary's funeral on Friday, and it was a beautiful funeral. Mary DuBois had been a member here for over probably 50 years, and she did a lot for this church. She, through her tithes and her offerings and through her time and her talent, she did a lot for West Newton, and we talked a lot about that on Friday at her service, and she was a beautiful soul. I loved Mary. I visited her at the nursing home many times, and she was a spitfire. She was a woman who spoke her mind. I love that about her, and I know that she is in heaven with her husband, Norvin, and they are having a great time. So, yeah, I'm glad that you mentioned that, because we do need to be definitely holding her sons in our prayers and her family, and to honor her. She was a really great saint of the church. So, you know, all summer long, we have been talking about spiritual warfare, and we have identified our enemy, who is Satan and his demonic forces. We have formulated our battle plan by putting on the whole armor of God. We have figured out how to overcome the accuser by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So today, with that in mind, we're going to consider a question that people have had on their minds throughout history. And it's a difficult question that our hearts say. And it's, why would the God who loves us and created us in his image allow so much suffering to go on in this world? And another way to put it is, why do bad things happen to good people? Why do bad things happen to good people? And unfortunately, I think sometimes people believe that when you become a Christian, it's just a walk in the park. It's easy. But it's not. We've found that out as we have studied the scriptures this summer, that, you know what, if you are not really making a lot of an impact in the world because of Christ, the devil will leave you alone, because honestly, you're on his side. Because if you're not on the side of Christ, you're on the side of Satan. But if you're somebody who stands up and advances God's kingdom through word and deed, Satan is going to take notice, and there are going to be consequences for that. And today we're going to look at one of the oldest stories in the Bible. It's about a man. The story is about a man named Job. And Job is one of the books in the Bible that is considered wisdom literature. I don't know if you've ever thought about it before, but the Bible is kind of like a library. There's lots of different books within the Bible. There are books of law and rule. There are books of songs and proverbs. There are apocalyptic books. There's gospels. There's letters. There's history. And there are wisdom books. And Job is one of those wisdom books. And actually, it's classified in Hebrew tradition as one of three wisdom books. Proverbs, Job, and Ecclesiastes are all of the wisdom books. In Proverbs, it talks about kind of daily life things and how God is wise and just. But in Ecclesiastes, they talk a lot about life is hard. And is God fair? So the book of Job kind of wraps all that up by saying, you know what, God is just and God is wise. So I want to introduce you to this man named Job. We read about him in Job chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. In the land of Uz, there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and he owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 donkeys, and a large number of servants. He was the greatest man among all the people of the East. His sons used to hold feasts in their homes on their birthdays, and they would invite their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. When a period of feasting had run its course, Job would make arrangements for them to be purified. Early in the morning, he would sacrifice a burnt offering for each of them, thinking, "Perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts." This was Job's regular custom. And as you can see from that description, Job was a pretty good guy. He was a pretty neat guy. He was morally upright. He shunned evil. He was blameless before God. He took his family's moral sanctity really seriously, sacrificing for them. And he was wealthy, too, in fact. And he was so well-respected, he was like the greatest of all the people in that land. But then we read on in Job, and we find that God is in his heavenly court. And as he is in his heavenly court, Satan comes to talk to him. Now, as we talked about last week, Satan comes before the throne of God, and he accuses the brethren before God. And that's what he was doing that day, too. He came to God, and he wanted to accuse Job, because God was saying, look how wonderful my servant Job is. He's just like he's the greatest guy. He's so blameless. And Satan says, well, you know what? The only reason he's blameless and he's so good and he honors you and praises you is because everything's going so great in his life. You have blessed him. That's why he's praising you, because you blessed him. And so to prove him wrong, God says this in verse 12. He says, very well then, everything he has is in your power, but on the man himself do not lay a finger. Then Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. And then what happens in the next chapter is, it's horrific. In the course of one day, 4 different messengers come to Job and tell him that everything he has been stolen or destroyed or killed. And even his children, all his children were in one house together, and the roof collapsed and they were all killed together. It is just almost unimaginable to think about the magnitude of that suffering. That's a terrible disaster. However, that's not really what happened to Job, is not what makes the story so remarkable, but the way that Job responded to his suffering. In Job 1:29, this is what we read. It says, at this, Job got up and tore his robe and shaved his head. Then he fell to the ground in worship and said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. In all this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. But that wasn't the end of Job's suffering, because Satan then goes back to God and he was like, well, I see he's still praising you, but you know what? It's because there's nothing that's happened to him physically. If I do something to him physically, he's going to curse you. And so God said, okay, go ahead. You can do something to him, but you can't kill him, but do what you will. And so then he afflicted Job with sores, painful sores, from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet. I'm just getting over shingles. I've had these painful sores. If you've ever had shingles, it's like it hurts from the inside out. And so I only had a really small patch of shingles. He had it all over his body. Immense pain. Satan's attacks on Job were terrible, overwhelming, intense, and yet Job was able to withstand the attacks of Satan by choosing faith over suffering. And church, we too can survive Satan's attacks by choosing faith over suffering. Faith is really a very powerful weapon of the church. However, faith is not like a magic eraser. And in order to be successful in our spiritual battle, we need to recognize that there are some things that faith cannot do when we are suffering. And the first thing that faith will not do is having faith will not eliminate the pain. Faith will not eliminate the pain. When Job was covered in sores from head to toe, his faith did not take away his pain. Those sores hurt so much that the scripture tells us that he sat on the ground and he took a broken piece of pottery and he tried to scrape the sores off, kind of like homemade surgery. And when his children were killed, he shaved his head, he tore his clothes, and he fell to the ground in mourning. Pain is real. Grief is real. Faith will not take away your pain. Faith will not take away your pain, and faith will also not prevent you, it will not keep you from asking questions. In the book of Job, the first two chapters are about great faith, and then the next 35 chapters are about great questions. Job isn't the only man in the Bible who questioned God. He wasn't the only one that had questions about suffering. I mean, the prophet Jeremiah could barely prophesy without weeping and crying over the devastation of what was happening in Israel. He kept asking God, how can you allow this devastation to happen to Israel when they were being taken over by foreign sources? And King David, he wrestled with questions all the time. Psalms 13 begins like this. How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Even in the garden, Jesus wrestled with questions. He was wrestling with suffering. In Luke 22:44, we read, and being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Faith is not going to take away your questions. And the third thing that faith will not do for you is that faith is not going to give you a logical answer for your suffering. Isn't that what we really want? We want a logical answer of why we are suffering. The book of Job is such an odd book. And having a story where God talks with the devil is very unsettling. And it's even more unsettling to know that he gives him permission to torment an upright, moral man. I mean, nothing about that story makes sense. And it's not a satisfying story. Like, we don't shut the book and go, well, that was good. No, we don't. It's not a satisfying story. But maybe that's part of the point. Maybe that's part of the point, because suffering doesn't make sense either. Suffering doesn't make sense. See, we want to be first paragraph Job, right? We want that to be true for our lives, the first paragraph of Job, the one that says that we are blameless and upright, the one that says we're righteous and the greatest person in all the land. We want to be first paragraph Job, because first paragraph Job doesn't have any suffering. But that's not real life. That's not real life, church. In real life, people get sick. And in real life, people we love die. And in real life, children rebel. And in real life, we have trouble. Trouble is going to come. And having faith in the middle of your trouble will not give you a logical explanation for it. So having pain, or having faith, is not going to eliminate your pain. It's not going to keep you from asking questions, and it's not going to give you a logical explanation. But there are things that faith will do for you. There are many benefits of having faith in the middle of suffering. And here's the first one. Choosing faith in the middle of suffering will remind you that God is in control. Choosing faith in the middle of your suffering is going to remind you that God is in control. When we choose faith, we choose to trust the God who allows these difficult circumstances to come into our life. If we look carefully at Job's story, throughout the entire event, there is never one time that God is not in control. Choosing faith doesn't allow God to be in control. God's already in control. It just reminds us that God has always been in control and always will be in control. God wasn't tricked by Satan. He wasn't tricked by Satan. He didn't misunderstand when Satan came to him. God carefully weighed his choices. He thought about the consequences, and he made a choice. At no time was God not out of control. So what are our options in the middle of out-of-control suffering? Well, I mean, we could reject God, right? We could blame God. A lot of people do. When things go south, lots of people blame God. Or we can trust the only one in all of creation who remains in control. And we can remember that God works all things together for our good according to his purpose. He works things all together for our good, according to his purpose. It might not seem like it at the time, but that's true, church. It might not seem like it's the right thing, but when God is in control, that is the truth. The second thing is that choosing faith in the middle of suffering becomes an amazing gift of worship to God. I mean, anybody can worship when you're having a good day. Anybody can worship when you're having a good day. But it takes somebody with extreme spiritual maturity and great faith to praise God in the middle of the suffering. When Job found out about all these terrible things that happened to him, he fell down on the ground, and it says he praised God. Job was able to praise God in the middle of his suffering. And then later on in Job 19:25, Job says, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand on the earth. So not only is he talking about what's happening now, he was prophesying to the end of the time that his Redeemer lived and he would stand on the earth. Church, if you're in the middle of suffering, you have this opportunity that is very unique to you right now. It's an incredible opportunity. If you can worship now in the middle of your suffering, that gift of worship is more valuable now than it will ever be. And the third thing is, choosing faith in the middle of your suffering will bring you closer to God. When we read on in Job in chapter 8, God speaks to Job out of a storm cloud. And God reveals himself in the most amazing way. And Job comes to have this greater understanding of him than he would ever have in his life. In fact, he didn't know it then, but he would have this more intimate experience with him than he could have ever imagined. Church, our brokenness can lead to openness. Our brokenness in our suffering can lead to openness. At the end of the book, we see how God blessed Job more than he ever had before by restoring his wealth, restoring his family. And Isaiah 63:1 says that God gives us beauty for ashes. I love that verse. God gives us beauty for ashes. We give him our sorrow and our brokenness, and he returns it with a crown of beauty. You know, I often begin my sermons with a story. Today I'm going to end with a story. This is actually a true story. There was a little boy, he was in kindergarten, and he was 5 years old. And he was so excited because he was making, in art class, they were making gifts for their parents. It was for Christmas. And what this little boy had was just a little lump of plaster. Really didn't look very, incredible or anything. Very remarkable. But you know what? With a little paint, a little glitter, and some time in the art room kiln, it came out in his eyes looking beautiful. So excited to give it to his dad. So it's the middle of December. All the parents come for the Christmas program. And then at the end of the program, all the kids run to their cubbies, they pull out their presents, and he had taken his and wrapped it in tissue paper with ribbon. He just thought it looked fantastic. And he runs to his dad to give him the gift. But then the unimaginable happens. He trips, the pottery goes airborne, hits the cafeteria floor, it's shattered into a million pieces. And the little boy shatters into a million pieces too. And he just crumples on the floor and he starts crying. And his parents run toward him and his father says, it's okay, son, it doesn't matter. But his mom stops and looks at the dad and says, oh no, it does matter. And she sat down on the floor with her little boy and she begins to cry with him. And she pulls him up on her lap and she holds him until he stops crying. And then she said, come on now, we're gonna take this and we're gonna see how we can make something out of this. And so with this mother's magic and glue gun, they put it together into a beautiful mosaic butterfly. And the butterfly ended up being so much more beautiful than that original piece of pottery. The artwork after the tragedy far surpassed what it was before. Church, grief is real and suffering hurts. But we remember that we're not alone in this. God walks beside us. And when we are crumbling in our suffering, God doesn't stand far off and go, well, that's too bad. He doesn't even come and pat us on the shoulder and say, there, there, it doesn't matter. He scoops us up in his arms, just like a loving mother. And he holds us tight and he weeps with us. And then something happens. When we begin to be so close to God, we begin to experience a new truth. It's a hard truth, but it's a miraculous truth, church. And the truth is this: in the Father's hand, suffering can give way to great beauty. Suffering can give way to great beauty. When we give ourselves over to the Creator, He can do more than just make a butterfly out of plaster. In God's time and in our brokenness, we can be gently put back together in a new way. And suddenly, we are even more beautiful than before. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for all things. Lord, I'm not going to say that we thank you for the suffering, but we do thank you, Lord, for what can come out of the suffering. We thank you that we know that you are there in our suffering, and that you can take what is broken in us and fashion it into something beautiful. We love you, Jesus. And it's in your blessed, precious name we pray these things. Amen. Really, I can't think of a better example of brokenness than this meal. That Jesus was willing to have a broken body so that we might experience new life. So amazing. And so as we come together at the table and we partake of these sacraments together, I want you to remember the beauty that is in this sacrifice. Will you join me in the communion liturgy? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with all your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. And by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, and you delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, he gave thanks to you, and he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine, and make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood, and by your Spirit make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
This is the body of Christ, broken for you. This is the blood of the Lamb poured out for you. I'd like to invite the communion stewards to come forward at this time. As part of the United Methodist Church, Wes Newton believes in open communion, which means you don't have to be a member of this church to partake in Holy Communion. If you feel called by God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, you should come down and partake of the sacraments. It's our custom that we begin at the back of the sanctuary, the communion. Stewards will give you a little squirt of hand sanitizer. You can come through the middle aisle. We put our hands in a little basket, and the stewards at the top in the front will drop it in and give you your juice cup as well. There are little bowls on the side on the communion pillars that you can drop your cup in afterwards, or you can take your cup back to your seat and put it in the railing on the back. This is also a time for prayer. If you want to come and pray at the altar, we want you to do that. If you want to come and receive a blessing from me and pray over you, I want to do that. The table is open. Come to the table. Church, as we go through this week, whatever trouble, whatever suffering that you are walking through, know that God is there with you, loving you, crying with you, and molding you into something beautiful. Go now in the peace, the mercy, the love of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said, Amen.
Stand against the power.